So now we're going to talk about the Goldman equation, which is how you can calculate the membrane potential when you have multiple ions involved in contributing to the membrane potential. Now, the assumption is that this equation is only good when the dV dt is equal to zero. That is, the membrane potential is not changing. And the idea is that although sodium-potassium fluxes set the value of the resting membrane potential, we know that the membrane potential is not equal to exactly the equilibrium potential for potassium or the equilibrium potential for sodium. We know that it lies somewhere in between if those were the two ions that were contributing to the membrane potential. So what this equation does is allows us to see the influence of these ions on the membrane potential at any particular spot where the membrane potential is not changing. So this equation would be the membrane potential would be equal to, and we'll just use 61.5. Those are some of the numbers that we, when we're at a certain body temperature. So we'll just say 61 to keep it easy. And it's divided by the absolute value of the valence, that's the charge of the ions, times the log, and then inside the log, we're gonna have the contributions of concentration and the ease at which the ion can cross the membrane, which we're gonna consider permeability as a surrogate for that. Units would be in terms of velocity in centimeters per second. And what we can do here is put in the permeability of sodium times its concentration on the outside of the cell, plus the permeability of potassium times the concentration of potassium on the outside. And then let's just throw in an anion. Let's make believe we're considering chloride. So chloride is negatively charged, and we have to reverse the concentration here, and we'll be on the inside. And that's all divided by the permeability of sodium times the concentration of sodium on the inside plus the permeability of potassium times the concentration of potassium on the inside plus the permeability of chloride times the chloride concentration on the outside. Now, the key point here is not to just plug the numbers into the equation and get a value. The idea is understanding what this equation is actually going to mean in terms of ion permeabilities and concentrations changing. So for example, a key point is if you increase the permeability of a given ion, what that means is that the membrane potential approaches the equilibrium potential for that ion. And I think you could appreciate that if for some reason we had a very high permeability for sodium, for example, okay? What that would do is that would make these other terms become insignificantly small. So if we took these permeabilities for sodium and made them go to a very high number, if these terms here drop out for potassium and chloride, then what essentially you end up with is the equilibrium potential for that ion. And I would encourage you to just plug some different numbers in, change the values of the permeability, and you'll be able to see that it does approach the equilibrium potential for that ion. And the reason why this is important is that at rest, we know that potassium has a high conductance, much higher than sodium. And this equation actually helps understand why the membrane potential at rest is close to the equilibrium potential for potassium. Now, it's not exactly the equilibrium potential for potassium because there is some crossing of sodium at rest. Now, if we took a different time, a membrane potential where it was at the peak of an action potential, for example, and you happen to get that moment where the membrane potential wasn't changing, there'd be a very high conductance for sodium and permeability for sodium, and then you would see the opposite. So V rest lies in between the equilibrium potential for sodium and the equilibrium potential for potassium. Remember, this is a negative number, typically under normal conditions, and the equilibrium potential for sodium is a positive number.